entire week we will be talking about neuro-ophthalmology, a topic which is very important, which needs a combined effort of both a neurophysician, neurosurgeon, and ophthalmologist. And this is one of the topics which needs to be dealt in detail. So we have given 6 days to it. There are different topics like examination techniques, approach to operation with disc edema, ocular motility, common optic neuropathies, visual field quiz, and neuroimaging. So today we have with us Associate Professor of All India Institute of Medical Sciences, RP Center, Dr. Swati Fulchele with us, who will be talking about examination techniques in neuro-ophthalmology. We are very grateful to Dr. Swati for having given us time for teaching the postgraduates today. I'd like to welcome Dr. Swati to please begin our presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Thank you for making me part of this wonderful postgraduate teaching program. Is my screen visible?
Not yet.
Okay. Yeah, is it? Is presentation visible?
Did you make it full screen?
Yeah, I'll do that. Is it okay now?
Yes, now perfect. Yes.
Yeah. So good evening all. I am Dr. Swati Fulchele. I am an associate professor at RP Center AIIMS. And I really thank Dr. Satyajit for making me part of this postgraduate program. Neuro-ophthalmology indeed is a kind of neglected branch, I would say, in residency because, you know, it's a little complicated. Although it's not so complicated, maybe residents feel that it is complicated and therefore they don't take too much amount of interest. So I will try to make their job a little easy, and I'll try to make this presentation an interesting one so that you develop some kind of interest in neuro-ophthalmology. It's indeed an interesting branch, just like medicine. So all those residents who are interested in the medicine part of the ophthalmology, I hope they'll enjoy it. So because this is an presentation about clinical examination, I have focused whole of my presentation into the art of history taking, because I personally believe that history in neuro-ophthalmology is very important, as it is in medicine, as you must have done in your MBBS course, that medicine has history component as a very strong component of the entire diagnosis. So I've stressed on history and of course clinical skills, which are very, very important in neuro-ophthalmology, because you know there are a lot of tests that are involved. So you have to have a very clear-cut clinical differential so that you know what tests to order, when to order, and how to order. I have touched a little bit about investigation, but that's just an overview, maybe in one or two, three slides, but my main focus is on the history taking and clinical examination. So as I have said, why it is important to have a good history taking art in neuro-ophthalmology, and why is it important to do a thorough clinical examination in neuro-ophthalmology? Why? Because there are battery of tests involved. You have optic nerve function tests on one side, and you have systemic investigations which include MRI, serology of various optic neuritis, as we are learning optic neuritis more and more, we are realizing there are a number of types of optic neuritis. I'm sure that will be dealt with in another presentation. I think probably Dr. Virendra Sachdeva would be talking about. Then CSF analysis, other autoimmune markers. So as I said, there are a lot of systemic investigation. So you don't know when to order, what to order. Will you order all of them together, which will be fair, and the yield will be very poor. So it's important that a clinical diagnosis is reached so that the localization of the lesion can be done and you can tailor your investigation according to that differential and localization. That's why it's very important. So in history, the first and the foremost thing is demographic profile. As you know, age of the patient is very, very important. Certain pathologies like optic neuritis are more common in younger age group, as in somewhere in 18 to 35 of age group, while ischemic optic neuropathies are more common in older age group, more than 50 years. Gender, again, optic neuritis is more common in females as compared to male. Then built, certain diseases like IH are seen in obese patients. So that's why it's very important, and place, of course. Now, geographical distribution, of course, matters with each and every disease, particularly in our setup, in Indian setup, where infections are much more common, while in Western setup, you have demyelination lesion, particularly MS, more common as cause of optic neuritis. So all these things need to be keep in mind, and it's therefore important to have, you know, a good document of demographic profile of the patient. Now, if you have noticed, or if you will understand, the patients of neuro-ophthalmology have three basic complaints. Of course, there are other complaints as well, but these are three very, very basic complaints you will have in neuro-ophthalmology. One is visual loss, other is diplopia, and the third one is headache or pain in eyes or painful ocular movements or something like that. So we have to deal with each one of them one by one. So to coming to vision loss, now you have to check whether it's a unilateral vision or a bilateral visual loss, then the nature of the visual loss, acute, subacute, gradual or transient. As you can see in this picture, you can see here that the vascular lesions usually cause vision loss within second 2 minutes. So if there is a vascular insufficiency, there will be vision loss immediately. Then inflammatory lesions like optic neuritis will have visual loss progressing over, you know, few hours to maybe 1 or 2 days. Now lesions like space occupying lesion or toxic optic neuropathies or raised ICT do progress over weeks to months, and probably SOL will take years before they, you know, manifest loss of vision. So it's important that that we understand how visual acuity was lost, whether it was sudden or subacute or transient. IH or TIAs are usually associated with transient visual obscuration. Then, as I said, unilateral or bilateral, certain diseases are unilateral, like optic neuritis, ischemic optic neuropathies, non-arteritic one, arteritic ischemic could be bilateral also. Genetic diseases like LHON are usually bilateral, toxic again are bilateral. So you have to keep this mind, these things in mind whenever you are taking our history of visual acuity loss. Then associated complaints like fever, whether it's associated with fever or not, whether the visual loss is painful, pain on ocular movements or not, pain we'll discuss later in next slide. Then extraocular movements also we'll discuss later, and field effects, of course, because sometimes, you know, patients are very intelligent, well-read, can give their complaint as I cannot see on the one side of the field. That's what they can complain at times. And at times they'll complain, I cannot see the inferior side of the field. I believe there is another class on visual field defect by Dr. Digvijay Singh. So I'm sure you'll learn more in that class, but this just gives you a differential diagnosis. So if there is bitemporal defect, you know you are dealing with chiasmal lesion. If you have an inferior visual field loss, you know you are dealing with an ischemic optic neuropathy. Central scotomas are most suggestive of toxic. If they are bilateral, unilaterals are most suggestive of optic neuritis. So that's why it's important that you need to ask all these associated complaints, even if patient do not report to you by themselves. Next is diplopia. Again, uniocular, binocular, we need to understand, because, you know, binocular diplopia is generally because of motor abnormality. So two eyes are not aligned with each other, while uniocular diplopia has cause in one eye only. For example, there can be polychoria, there can be dislocation of IOL or dislocation of crystalline lens, or there can be eccentric pupil. So these are the causes of uniocular. So you have to definitely ask patient whether the diplopia is uniocular or binocular. You can close one eye and ask patient to see. Then again, whether it's painless or painful. Now, painless diplopia is generally associated with ischemic lesions or something like that. But painful is the most common cause, as we say, this aneurysm. Especially if it's a third nerve palsy, you have to be very, very careful that a painful third nerve palsy, severe headache is a sign of aneurysm. Then pain can also be present in inflammatory conditions. Painful ocular movements are seen in optic neuritis. Then whether it's constant, whether the diplopia is constant or intermittent, that also gives you an idea, because IIH may have intermittent diplopias if there are phases of six nerve paresis. And it's also important to know which is worse in which gaze. That will give you a clue which muscle or which nerve is involved. Then pain or headache. So we need to ask whether the pain is there on ocular movements, whether it's a mild retrobulbar pain, which can be seen sometimes with ischemic headache. Severe temporal headache is a sign of arteritic ischemic optic neuropathy, and it is an ocular emergency. So you have to ask about all this thing, then there can be severe throbbing headache in cases of any, you know, raised ICT or intracranial lesion or particularly aneurysms. Aneurysms have very, very severe headache. Patient will complain, I have the worst headache of my lifetime. So that's a sign. Hemicranial headache is a sign of migraine. Then unexplained pain can also be there, which can be there in inflammatory lesions. Then you have to ask whether the pain is constant or intermittent and whether it's associated with vomiting or not, to know whether whether it's associated with IH or not, because pain or a headache associated with vomiting is a sign of IH. Then you also need to ask for, of course you have to examine, but you also need to ask for associated neurological complaints like loss of consciousness, loss of sensation, because that will help you in localization of lesion, motor loss, if there is any autonomic dysfunction is commonly seen with NMO kind of optic neuritis, in particularly incontinence of bowel and bladder, sweating and hydrosis is seen with Horner syndrome. And of course, gait balance also you have to see. Past history, it's important because, you know, sometimes you on fundus examination, it may be confusing that one eye has pallor, other eye has disc edema. So it's important that you ask so that if there was any previous episode of similar disease or any previous history of fever, infection, because patient may come to you after so many years and you are still unaware. Patient will come with just pallor and you will be clueless that what is the cause of pallor. So it's important that you ask for all this history. Diabetes, hypertension, cardiac dysfunction is associated with, you know, mononeuropathy. So we need to ask for all this, especially if there is mononeuropathy. Thyroid dysfunction also becomes important. Thyroid can cause, of course, diplopia as well as compressive optic neuropathy both. So it's important. Again, other autoimmune disease can involve optic nerve and also can cause cranial neuropathy. So it's important that you ask. Then other neurological episodes are also important. Important to ask drug use, drug abuse, because that can cause toxic optic neuropathy. History of any recent surgery, particularly severe, very severe blood loss can cause ischemic optic neuropathy, posterior ischemic optic neuropathy. Recent weight gain can be a sign to tell you that probably patient has IH. Weight loss can be associated with thyroid, hyperthyroidism, and other hormonal changes are important. You know, for pituitary lesions, if there are hormonal changes, you know, probably lesion is somewhere around the pituitary. So these are important things to note and ask whenever a patient comes to you. Family history, LHON, as we know, has a maternal inheritance. So it's important to ask whether the similar episode is present there in maternal uncles or in maternal aunts or children of maternal aunts, because it's an X-linked disease. Then autosomal dominant optic neuropathy, you may have to go through a family tree to understand the differential. So all these things have to be kept in mind whenever we have to take history. Then coming to examination. So of course, a routine thorough examination is important in neuro-ophthalmology. You have to examine visual acuity, then ocular motility, pupil, fundus examination, color vision, contrast vision, and visual fields can be done bedside also, and there are specialized tests for doing the same. Right, so I'll come to them one by one. So visual acuity, it's important to take for both near and distance, because loss of accommodation can be sign of some other lesion, while distance visual acuity can be involved in many optic neuropathies. Role of refraction cannot be undermined. Sometimes, many a times we get a patient that one eye patient is not able to see answer, and we do a refraction and find out that's simply a case of an isometropic amblyopia. So it's important that a proper refraction is done in spite of the fact that you are in a busy OPD or in hurry. Please, please, please do not neglect refraction, because we find it very oftenly coming to us patients like that. One eye is, emmetropic, other eye has +4, +5, and patient cannot see. So it has been referred, fundus normal, has been referred as optic neuropathy. But please check the refractive error before you label them as optic nerve disease. Then pupil examination. Pupil are the single most test that can tell you whether the optic nerve is involved or not. So you have to look for multiple things like pupil size and shape to know whether the efferent is involved or the afferent is involved. to check for light reaction, both a direct as well as consensual. Near reflex also, there are condition in which light reflection may be impaired, but the near reflex may be normal. Then also check for pupil dilatation also, RAPD and light near dissociation. So what is the pathway for light reflex? This is just for revision, especially because this is meant for residents. I thought I'll revise it for you people. So the afferent consists of the optic nerve itself. It goes along the visual pathway, then it is relayed at the pretectal nucleus. From pretectal nucleus, the fibers go to Edinger Westphal nucleus, and from Edinger Westphal nucleus of the third nerve, the fibers travel along the ocular motor nerve, specifically along the inferior division of the ocular motor nerve. They get relayed here at ciliary ganglion and finally supply the iris sphincter muscle. So this is how the afferent and the efferent pathway of light reflex is there. So you have to check for pupil size, because difference in size of pupil is an isochoria, and that tells you that defect is not there in afferent but in efferent. So an afferent defect never leads to an isochoria. Why? Because the other eye is getting stimulation from the normal eye. So the affected eye gets stimulation from the normal eye. So the afferent defect is not going to get not going to cause an isochoria, while an efferent defect will definitely cause an isochoria. So whenever you have to check the direct response to light, you have to make sure that's a dimly lit quiet room, bright light source, and the light is shown in one eye. I'm sorry, this media is not playing. It was playing. I'll just show this video. Yeah, is this video visible to you now?
So
you can see that the moment light is shown in the right eye, both eyes have constricted. Similarly, now the light will be shifted on the left side. Video is not running?
No.
Okay, let me check that again. I think I'll have to. Is it visible now?
We can see the. That's the still of the video, anurag.avi.
Okay.
It's working.
Now it's running.
Now it's running, is it?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so you can see that whenever the light is shown in the one eye, both eye pupil constrict. So as in this case, right eye, see both eyes have constricted. Now the torch would be shifted to the left side. Now they have dilated because light source is no more there, and the torch would be shifted on the left side, and see the both eye pupil are constricted. So this is what it is. You have direct response in one eye and the consensual response in other eye. I'll go back to my presentation. Right. Right, okay. So now presentation is visible, is it?
You can make it full screen.
Yeah, I did that. So what you have to make sure is a room and a bright light source, and the light has to be shown in both the eyes equally. And whenever you move from one side to other side, it has to be moved in downward direction and has to be repeated several times before you can be sure about the reflex. So as I said, there is a direct response, pupillary capture, followed by pupillary escape. And there's a consensual response, which is equal both in velocity and amplitude to the direct response. So both direct and consensual are equally strong. So if you have a disparity, you know there is an afferent defect. Okay, I'll show a video about RAPD later on as in this case. So I will switch, I think I'll switch back to this video thing. Is this video visible now?
We can't see the video yet.
I hope it's visible now. I've changed my settings.
It is visible.
Yeah. So when the light is shown on the right side, see both pupil have constricted. There is a pupil capture and the pupillary escape. But the moment the light is shifted on the left side, one can see that both eyes have dilated. So that is what is RAPT. So both eyes will dilate if the light is shown in the on the abnormal side. Okay, so I'll go. I have only those two videos, so pardon me for the interruption. I'll go back to my presentation. So yes, you can clinically grade also this, because that gives you a slight idea about the severity of the lesion. It's not always correlate, but it gives you a slight idea. So you can have a clinically trace video, which means trace RAPT, which means that there is an initial constriction followed by greater escape. Then you have grade 1 to grade 2, where there is no constriction followed by dilatation, and grade 3 to grade 4, when there is immediate dilatation. So these are just a clinical grading, but you can definitely quantify the amount of RAPD by using neutral density filters. So similar to the light reaction, we also have pupillary dilatation, which is supplied by the sympathetic pathway. The first order neurons for the sympathetic pathway arise from hypothalamus. They descend down to C8 to T2 level, where they synapse and they ascend up the second order exit from the T2 level. They ascend up, join the sympathetic chain along the sympathetic chain, and they synapse here at the superior cervical ganglion. The post ganglion are the third order neurons, which exit superior cervical ganglion, travel along with the internal carotid artery, enter into cavernous sinus, and then through long ciliary nerves they supply to the dilator pupillae. So pupillary dilatation is as important as pupillary constriction, because you know pupillary dilatation will also tell you that there is something wrong with the sympathetic pathway. So a normal time for dilatation is around 10 to 15 seconds, and if there is a dilatation lag more than 25 seconds, then you probably know that there is a defective sympathetic innervation. Similarly, you have to check for both near reflex also, so that you can assess if there is a light near dissociation. So when you should be giving the patient an accommodative target, not any light source, because you don't want light reflex to come into picture. So rather you would give an accommodative target and see whether the pupil is reacting or not. So there are certain conditions like dorsal midbrain lesions, Argel-Robertson pupil, which is seen in syphilis, Eddie's pupil, and aberrant regeneration of third nerve. These are the condition where the pupil is not going to react to light source, but is definitely going to react to an accommodative target. So it tells you indirectly where the lesions are and how to investigate the case further. After you are done with pupillary examination, we come to fundus examination. But before that, I'd like to tell that if pupils are normal, if you have no RAPD, then probably you have to make sure that you're not dealing with an optic nerve lesion, because any kind of optic nerve lesion will have a relative afferent pupillary defect. So once you have started examining optic nerve head, look for the shape of the head, the margins, the color, and the cup. So you may have a normal, absolutely normal looking fundus in cases like retrobulbar neuritis. That possibility is also there. You may have a tilted disc, as in this picture you can see, and it can be easily confused with disc, sometimes with disc edema, sometimes with optic nerve hypoplasia. So these things have to be kept in mind. Then you may have optic nerve head drusen, as in this case you can see that it's appearing that the disc is elevated, the margins are fuzzy, but if you will carefully observe that there are no other signs of disc edema. This is a case of disc edema. How do you diagnose a disc edema and what are the other signs? It's there in on the next slide, but before that we go through this. So, and there is a possibility that you may see nothing but a temporal pallor. So this is an evidence of some previous optic nerve pathology, may not be a current one. So these are the common fundus findings or disc findings you may have, not a fundus finding, but disc findings, I would say. There are other fundus findings also. So after this, you don't limit your examination just to disc, look at the vascular architecture also. So sometimes congenital lesions and like drusens can have abnormal branching, anomalous branching, excessive tortuosity of vessels. In cases of disc edema, I need not tell you there will be venous engorgement, veins would be dilated. Optociliary shunt can be seen in the orbital compression lesions, particularly meningiomas and gliomas. So these you can see there are these fine vessels. These are the optociliary shunt that occur because of the compression, direct compression of the optic nerve in the intraorbital region. You also need to check about the AV junction, because that will give you a sign whether there is a sign of hypertensive retinopathy or not. Then there is a venous bleeding, and please don't fail to check for the spontaneous venous pulsation. They may not be present in all the patients, but whenever present, they tell you that there is no raised ICT or no edema. Then associated features like splinter hemorrhages are seen in ischemic optic neuropathies. Then macular star can be seen in hypertensive grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy as well as neuroretinitis. So you have to make sure. So whenever you see a disc edema with macular star, please don't jump to the diagnosis of neuroretinitis. Please check the BP of the patient, because, and you can also observe the other eye. Hypertensive retinopathies are generally bilateral, while neuroretinitis will be unilateral. Then you may have severe disc edema with hemorrhages, again suggestive of raised ICT, papillary edema. You may have hemorrhages all over fundus and not just disc. So when you have this kind of picture, hemorrhages scattered all over fundus, you are probably dealing with a retinal vascular occlusion and not the disc lesion. So that is also very important to understand. That just don't just feel that there's a disc edema and hemorrhages, it means that there is an ischemic optic neuropathy or something like that. I'm sorry for the interruption. Yeah. So please have a look at overall fundus also. And then there can be telltale signs of previously occurred disc edema. As in this case, you can see all the margins are blurred. There is this whitish appearance. I think it's clear. There's this whitish appearance, gliotic changes. These are known as gliotic changes. They are telltale signs of a previous episode of disc edema. And these are the semicircular lines, you know, along the contour of the disc, which is, these are known as pattern lines, and they are suggestive of resolved disc edema. So look for all these finer aspects to diagnose whether the disc edema is true or not. Then it's very important to do peripheral examination. Don't just limit your examination to disc also. Why? Because, you know, disc edema can be associated with a disease like this. So this is a white dot syndrome, could be a choroiditis also. So just, it's not enough to do a disc examination. Dilate the fundus and do a proper peripheral fundus examination. In this case, it could be very well a hypertensive choroidopathy. So it's important to look at the periphery equally. Now, swollen disc, what are the signs of swollen disc? Are we coming to the swollen disc? It's very important to, you know, differentiate a pseudo disc edema from a true disc edema. Most of this time I've seen residents reporting the cases pseudo disc edema as disc edemas. Why? Because, you know, they just rely on the fuzzy margin and see that the margins are blurred, and therefore it's a case of disc edema. No, just blurred margins are not enough. So a stereoscopic examination with 90 diopter or 78 diopter, whatever kind of, or IO if you use, please do a stereoscopic examination to see if the disc is raised or not, number one. Number two, also see the obscuration of the peripheral peripapillary vessels, not just any vessels, peripapillary vessels to begin with. So in early disc edema, you have this obscuration of peripapillary vessels, then venous engorgement, presence of any exudates or hemorrhage, and presence of venous pulsation. So look at all these factors before you label them as a true disc edemas. The causes of disc edemas papilledema, papillitis, malignant hypertension, ischemic optic neuropathies, diabetic optic neuropathy, CRVO, or any kind of intraocular inflammation, as I've shown in the earlier slide, previous slide, can cause disc edema. You may have dyspallor. So dyspallor can be because of primary optic atrophy. That means that the margins are absolutely sharp and clear. So primary optic atrophy is an optic atrophy where margins are absolutely sharp and clear, and there are no other signs of disc edema. Causes could be toxic, traumatic, compression, congenital, or secondary to any lesion at the macula which can cause retinal atrophy, or particularly papillomacular bungel atrophy. Then you can have, on the other hand, you can have the secondary optic atrophy, where the optic atrophy occurs secondary to the disc edema. So any kind of pathology that causes disc edema, ischemic optic neuropathies or papillitis or papilledema, is going to lead to secondary optic atrophy. So this you need to differentiate. Then after fundus examination, it's important to check for ocular movement. So you have in ocular movement, check for duction, that is uniocular movement, versions, binocular movement, vergence, convergence, and divergence. It's important for certain lesions, midbrain lesions particularly. Then doll's eye movement, again, because gaze palsies may have, supranuclear palsies may have normal doll's eye movements. So you have to check for doll's eye movement, saccades, pursuit, vestibular. You may not be able to check, you know, all of them as an ophthalmologist or a resident may be difficult, but the first four, or including saccades and pursuit, it's not so difficult to check. Saccades and pursuit, saccades are the fixation movement. So you ask patient to fix from one finger to another finger immediately. You know, the patient is not supposed to follow. You have to, a patient has to fix from one object to another, and you can judge qualitative speed of fixation of from and compare it from the normal eye or the normal person. So that will give you an idea about the second. Then pursuit movements are the follow movements. So you can ask patient to follow any particular target, unfurling of a ribbon or a following a pendulum. So that gives you an idea about the pursuit movement. Some neurological disorders have abnormal saccades and pursuits. So it's important, and even some myopathies can have abnormal saccades. So these are important to check. So ocular motility examination, you check for the third nerve. So third nerve supplies to all extraocular muscles except for superior oblique and lateral rectus. So this is a case of right third nerve palsy, and you can see that the elevation, that there is a ptosis, elevation is affected, and depression is not so much affected, but mildly affected. And adduction is also not so much affected. It's a partially recovered one, because, but definitely elevation is affected. So third nerve palsy can be a complete or a partial third nerve palsy, depending on the cause and the stage. Then this is a case of sixth nerve palsy, left side. You can see that there is a limitation of abduction. Fourth nerve palsy, you can see that there is a hypertropia, which is worsening on the same side till there's head posture also. And this is the most inferior one. You can see that, you know, it's a very interesting case. Now, if you see, look at all these up figures, you can see that the patient is unable to move his right eye on the left side. So left adduction is limited, right? But on doll's eye movement, it has moved completely. So this tells you probably there is a supranuclear lesion. And the lesion is not at the level of cranial nerve, it's probably at the level of gaze center. So these are the things we need to check. Okay, so it is not. Then after you are done with the ocular motility examination, it's important to do a visual field examination and color vision. So you really don't need any fancy equipments to do so. A simple bedside confrontation test with a red object can give you the idea. It is not going to exactly tell you how severe is the lesion, or may not be able to, you know, delineate the exact contour of the scotoma, but definitely can give you the rough idea. It is little time taking, but yes, it can. There are very quick and easy method of doing this. The simplest way to examine the color vision is to show a red object and ask patient to cover each eye. So an abnormal eye will have faded color. The patient will tell you that with this eye, I'm seeing faded color. Similarly, for the visual field examination or the confrontation field examination, each eye has to be tested individually, and the first step is to have patient the examiner face. So you just have to ask patient, can you see my face? The patient will say yes, I can, but I cannot see your nose. That tells you that this is a probably central scotoma. You are dealing with central scotoma. The other option is that patient may tell you, I cannot see the inferior part of your face. That gives you an idea that probably you are dealing with the altitudinal defect, which is seen with the ischemic optic neuropathy. Then patient may tell you, I cannot see the right or the left side of your face. So that is also an indication that you are probably dealing with hemianopias. So it's not so difficult. And if you use this with the red object or a bottle with a red cap, it helps the sensitivity increases and helps to delineate the scotoma in a better way. The next step is to show fingers. So first step is to show face. The second step is to show fingers in four quadrants. And you have to fold your fingers on the each side of vertical as well as horizontal. So first you can follow either do a horizontal or do a vertical, whatever. And you just have to ask them the clarity, whether the amount of clarity on both sides is equal or not. Or you can simply ask them to count the number of fingers and can tell you whether there is any defect on the east side or not. Once the defect is found, you may or may not do it, you know, because depending on the time you have, and now that we have better ways of delineating the visual field defects, you may not do it. But once the defect is found, you can move your fingers and to the level where patient is able to see the finger. So that gives you the extent of the scotoma. You can, in this way, you can establish the boundary of the field defect, you know. So that can be done. But what I would like to emphasize is that, you know, neuro-ophthalmology examination does not end just with the ophthalmology examination. You have to do some kind of neurology examination also. So these are the various subset of neuro examination: mental status, cranial nerves, other cranial nerves apart from the ocular cranial nerves, motor examination, coordination, sensory, and gait. I completely understand that it's not possible for us to do all of the examination, but I would definitely like to insist that do some kind of motor and sensory examination, particularly if patient is complaining of any sensation or motor loss. If patient is not complaining of any such kind of loss, you can let it go. But what is more important to examine the fifth nerve and the seventh nerve. So fifth nerve, as you already know, has three divisions. And the simplest way to examine fifth nerve is to check for the corneal blink reflex. So if corneal sensations are intact, you know your fifth nerve is intact. That helps you in localization of lesions. So if multiple cranial nerves are involved, then you know probably that the lesion is at the orbital apex where all the cranial nerve converge. So that's one sign. The next is to examine the facial nerve, because, you know, sixth cranial nerve is very, the nucleus for the sixth cranial nerve lies very close to the seventh cranial nerve. So if the seventh cranial nerve, in fact, forms a genu around the sixth cranial nerve. So sometimes in a nuclear cases or in pontine cases, sixth and seventh can be involved together. So it's important that to examine the seventh nerve, and the simplest way is to ask patient to frown or to blow or to smile. That gives you an idea whether the seventh nerve is involved or not. And seventh nerve also, you know, acts as efferent to corneal blink reflex. So it's important that you examine both fifth and seventh nerve. With that, I come to the conclusion of the examination part. As far as investigations are concerned, as I've already told you, there are a long list of investigations. So once you have reached to a conclusion with your history and your examination, you have reached to sets of differential. You may not be able to reach to a definitive diagnosis, but sets of differentials can always be made out, or you can be able to localize a lesion, like, as I said, multiple cranial nerve involvement is a sign of lesion at the orbital apex. Then an abnormal ocular motility but normal Bell's reaction or normal dorsi movement is a sign of supranuclear lesion. So you know that there is an intracranial problem and you need to order MRI. Disc edemas, disc atrophies, again, depending on at what age, what type of edema, what was the history, you will have to understand the differentials and then order the investigation. So if you have disc edemas, especially bilateral, then you know you are dealing with papillary edemas, and you may have to order a neuroimaging, which could be MRI. MRI is generally the choice of neuroimaging for neuro-ophthalmological disorders, and MRI has to be a contrast MRI with a proper protocol. Then you may have to do other blood investigations, like routine blood investigations. Nowadays, we are looking for NMO antibodies, MOG antibodies in cases of optic neuritis. CSF analysis may be important to rule out infectious optic neuropathies, and also to rule out raised ICT. Then genetic analysis is important for LHON. Color and contrast vision test. As you all know, they are commonly done. Ishihara test is available. You have FAMS, FM 100 test. And then you have other tests also available, but the most important and commonly used is the Ishihara test. Then you have contrast test, which can be done with FACT chart or the Pelli-Robson chart or the Bailey's chart, whatever chart you have. But the simplest way, as I said, it can be done bedside also. So this cannot be an excuse that I have not checked for color and contrast, because you know you can show any bright object and ask patient to see with either eye whether there is any fading or not, whether the contrast is same or not, whether there is blurriness on one side on the image of one eye as compared to the other eye. All those things can be done bedside also. Coming to field defects, you can have confrontation test, as I've already explained. Then you have automated test, which are done routinely, and you have kinetic perimetry, Goldman test, which is not so radially easily available nowadays. But studies have shown that automated perimetry is as good as kinetic perimetry in around 90% of cases, and they may be able to pick up all kinds of visual field defect, except which are in extreme periphery. By that I mean which are beyond 60-70 degrees, and that are usually seen in occipital lobe lesions. There is a temporal crescent, but in most of the other disorders, automated perimetry suffices for kinetic perimetry. The simplest way to test is to give an Amsler grid chart, and central scotomas can be picked on it. But I think most of us are doing SAP as automated perimetries nowadays. Then fundus fluorescein angiography is also one test which is not so frequently used, but yes, is very useful when used. So it can help you in differentiating papillary edema versus pseudo papillary edema. So frank disc edema or papillary edema will cause this frank leakage of dye all around the disc, while if it's a pseudo papillary edema, as in this case, you will see that there is no leakage. Then it can also help in differentiating arthritic versus non-arthritic ischemic optic neuropathies, because in arthritic there will be this choroidal non-perfusions areas, choroidal ischemia, there will be delayed feeling, as you can see in this case, while in non-arthritic it may not be so. There may be delayed feeling of the disc in non-arthritic also, but severe choroidal imperfusion is a sign of arthritic ischemic optic neuropathy. Then disc drusen is one thing that can be diagnosed on autofluorescence itself. So if you see this kind of picture, you are sure that this is not a true disc edema. This is a pseudo disc edema, and the most probable cause is exposed disc drusen. Nowadays, role of OCT is kind of expanding day by day in neuro-ophthalmology. We do have various indications for OCT, like assessment of disc edema. So OCT can also be, sometimes be used to differentiate whether it's a true disc edema or a pseudo disc edema. So if it's a true disc edema, you will have retinal nerve fiber layer thickening. You will have ganglion layer thickenings in cases of true disc edema. While in pseudo disc edemas, these may be normal. Then you may also use this as a follow-up, that once you have diagnosed a disc edema, particularly in IH, if you have diagnosed that the disc edema is there and you want to know the response to your therapy, so you can serially monitor the patient's OCT and see whether the RNFL thickening is coming down or not, to understand whether the disc edema is responding to your treatment or not. Sometimes it has also been seen, particularly in cases of optic neuritis, that asymptomatic eyes of optic neuritis also show some kind of RNFL thinning and ganglion cell layer thinning. It can be used for progression of chronic optic neuropathies and diseases, neurological diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinsonisms have also shown to have you know, thinning of RNFL or thinning of GCL in eye. So this is an indirect way of measuring axonal loss in cases of Alzheimer's and Parkinsonism. Also, to understand whether if you follow them, if you monitor them, you'll also understand that their therapy is working or not, if there is any further loss or not. Then coming to neuroimaging, is there are various types of imaging available: MRI, MRV, MRA, and CT. But the most common neuroimaging that is done in neuroophthalmology is indeed MRI with contrast, unless it's an acute hemorrhage where CT is more useful. Aneurysms, if large enough, can be diagnosed on MRI also, but if they are very small and you are very high suspicion, as I said, they can cause very severe throbbing kind of headache. So you have to understand that you will have to order MR angiography. Then MRV is useful in cases of raised ICT when you do not have SOLs. So if you have no space occupying lesion and you cannot explain your papilledema, you can look for cortical venous thrombosis on MRV, which can itself can cause papilledema and raised ICT. Then electrophysiology, of course, you have numerous electrophysiology tests. You have to understand that demyelinating disorders, particularly anishemic optic neuropathies, show very delayed kind of latency as compared to toxic and other compressive optic neuropathy, where the amplitude is more affected. The electrophysiology is not a very helpful thing for definitive diagnosis or the etiological diagnosis. It is helpful to differentiate it from the retinal causes, where the ERG will be more affected than the VER. So if the latency is more affected, you know, probably you are dealing with the optic nerve disorder rather than the retinal disorder. Then other than that, you have multiple other investigation, blood investigation. I think I've spoken about them earlier also. And especially for myasthenia, which I'm not told earlier, you have this Edofonium test or neostigmine test or repeat nerve stimulation test, and single muscle electromyography can be done. So with this, I conclude my presentation, and thank you for your patient listening. I hope I'm not taking too much amount of time. All questions are welcomed. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We'll just wait for a few questions from the postgraduates in the chat box.
Sure. I hope they found it useful.
Interesting, very nice. What is IH? Dr. Swati, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
The first question is, what is IH?
I'm sorry if I didn't elaborate it. It's idiopathic intracranial hypertension. Earlier was known as benign intracranial hypertension, but now we understand that it's no more benign. It can cause severe visual deficits. Then I think Dr. Abhishek has also asked one more question, that whether the unilateral glaucomatous optic neuropathy may cause RAPD. Yes, if it is severe, only in end stage, not in early stage. So if you have a cupping of, you know, 5-6 and you say that there is an RAPD, then it's probably not glaucomatous. It has to be a total dyspallor with a severe cupping around probably near total or total cupping to cause RAPD in cases of glaucoma. I think there is one more question from Shreya. Shreya has asked, ma'am, I find problem in checking consensual right reflex. Please tell the room requisite. As I said, you have to do it in a dimly lit room. Don't do it in a bright room, or don't do it in an entirely dark room. Why? Because if you will do it in an entirely dark room, you will not be able to see the other eye. So the best thing is to take patient near a window. in a dimly lit room, I take patient near a window and ask patient to fix at a distance and shine the torch in one eye and check for the reflex in the other eye also. Because the patient is near the window, you may be able to see the reflex in the other eye. But yes, I understand there is a possibility that you may not have window or any access to a window. So in that case, what you can do, you can use your hand or ask someone, take someone else's hand and put a barrier between two eyes like this. Okay. And with one light source directly on the eye, with the eye where you are checking the direct reflex, and the other light source on a diffuse, which will be a very diffuse. It is not direct. Okay, so one is a direct, other is a very relatively diffuse kind of a light source. So this will be your indirect ophthalmoscope, which is a direct light source. And this can be a kind of torch with multiple layers of tape or torch, which is partially covered with your hand. And the patient is looking at the distance, so you have to put this barrier. You can do it with your hand. You can put any notebook or any card, any paper, whatever is available to you, and look. So when you shine light on, say, example, your right eye, you should be able to see the reflex in your left eye. So this is what is consensual reflex. The next question is how to differentiate chronic papillary edema established and resolving. See, established papillary edema is the second stage of papillary edema. You have first early papillary edema where the signs will be there of this blurring of disc margin with probably one or two hemorrhages and elevated disc with mild venous engorgement. But once this established stage has occurred, then you have little more hemorrhages, some exudates around the disc. While in chronic case, you will have more severe hemorrhages. If we have time, I can show pictures. Can I do that, Dr. Satyajit, if you allow me?
Absolutely. Okay. Absolutely.
I am not sure. Just give me a second.
You can take your time. Over.
This is just to show various types of papillary edema, because you know I face this question quite commonly, and residents do get confused how to grade that papillary edema. So let me see if I can do that. In chronic papillary edema, you will have many more exudates, and at the same time, you know, you will see your disc as a pale disc. I have one presentation here where I have pictures of different stages of papillary edema. Yeah, this is just to show that this is a very early stage. All you can see, is this presentation visible?
Yes.
Yeah, so this is a very early stage where you can see, all you see is a hyperemia of the disc with mild disc blurring here and few hemorrhages here. So this is a very early stage. Then you have a established stage where you have much more severe disc edema and exudates. And this is what is chronic stage will look like, you know, disc pallor, severe engorgement. Somehow I don't have the entire picture over here, but the severity and the amount of exudates will be much, much more. Then you have this atrophic stage, you know, where everything else is resolved, but what you can see is the blood disc margins with these gliotic changes. That's what I was speaking about earlier when I said these are the telltale signs of earlier episode of Discedema. At the same time, there are these watermarks. Is it visible? There's this fine line suggestive of watermarks. So this is a sign of resolved discedema, and this is also this patent lines here. Okay, I hope Abhijit, now it's clear to you what are the various stages of discedema.
Yes, that was very nice pictorial description.
Thank you. Then Abhishek has a question that myelinated nerve fibers cause RAPD. No, they do not cause RAPD. Because the light is anyway being transmitted, so why will they cause RAPD? And pattern of retinal hemorrhages in optic nerve pathology and retinal pathology. I think that's a very, very important question. You know, generally the classical teaching is that if you have hemorrhages which is beyond 1 disc diameter of the disc, so any hemorrhage which is, you know, 1 disc diameter, beyond 1 disc diameter of the disc, is probably not related to disc pathology. It's probably a retinal lesion. So if you have a hemorrhage somewhere in periphery of retina and you have disc edema, so to say that this is a disc pathology is a very wrong thing. You will probably have to find out the retinal cause for it. When is it papilledema and when is it grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy? See, papilledema is not a diagnosis. Let me very, very clearly tell you that papilledema is a clinical manifestation of raised ICT. Okay, so whenever you have raised ICT, the bilateral disc edema is known as papilledema. Okay, but not all bilateral disc edemas are papilledemas. For example, if you have bilateral ischemic optic neuropathies or if you have bilateral papillitis, there will be disc edema in both the eyes, but then again, it is not papilledema because it's not secondary to the raised ICT. And how do you differentiate? Well, it's very important to differentiate them. Why? Because the whole treatment and the investigation protocol is different. So papilledema usually will have normal visual functions unless it has reached a chronic stage. So normal visual acuity, normal pupillary variations, normal color vision, normal contrast vision. Field will be one thing that will be abnormal in form of papilledema, will have enlarged blind spot and peripheral constriction of the field. I think I can show that also here. So see, you can see that there is an enlarged, is it visible? There is an enlarged blind spot in both the eyes. So this is very, very classical of papilledema, right? I may be having this table somewhere to differentiate papilledema and papillitis, yes. So as I said, the visual loss is not there in papilledema in early stages. Pupillary reactions are also preserved. Then in papillitis, you have moderate to severe vision loss depending on the type of the optic nerve pathology. The field effects are central to central scotal scotoma, and you will all definitely have RAPD. So the question was that whether the grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy will be called as papilledema. No, you are not going to call it as papilledema. We'll simply call it as grade 4 hypertensive retinopathy, which will mean that there is a bilateral disc edema along with choroidopathy, along with AV vascular changes. Okay, is that clear? Significance, yes. Of color vision and contrast sensitivity. Optic nerve pathologies are one of the most sensitive, to color vision and contrast vision. You know, sometimes there is a possibility that you may have subclinical involvement, particularly in optic neuritis. So color vision and contrast, abnormal color vision, decreased contrast sensitivity are the only way to diagnose the subclinical involvement of optic nerve. So in one eye, there is a possibility in one eye patient has full blown optic neuritis, that the vision is poor, patient has 660 kind of vision, but in other eye, patient will just simply complain that I can see only faded things. Or there is a possibility that patient may have 6-6 vision entirely, but patient has faded color vision. So you don't dismiss, unless it's a congenital vision color vision loss, of course. But you don't dismiss that your vision is normal and therefore you have no optic nerve pathology. So it's important, look for RAPD, look for that, you know, small color vision defects, small contrast vision defects. In fact, optic neuritis, in cases of optic neuritis, the amount of color vision loss is significantly more as compared to the vision loss itself. Okay. Are there any more questions? No, I think that's it.
Okay. So we'd like to bring this session to an end. That was the only questions we have from the postgraduates. We are very grateful to Dr. Swati for having taken out time for this presentation. If anybody has any questions in future, they'll write to me and I can forward it to you at a later time. Thank you very much for your time and presentation. I would also like to thank Intas Pharmaceuticals for bringing this together, and like to thank the postgraduates who joined us this evening. Tomorrow we'll have approach to a patient with disc edema by Dr. Professor Rohit Saxena from All India Institute of Medical Science, New Delhi, tomorrow at 5 o'clock. Thank you so much, Dr. Swati, once again. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.